I recycled more than 100 3D Benchy boards by grinding them up and extruding the material into new filament. We'll take a look at how it prints and even test its strength. Let's find out more. Guten Tag everybody, I'm Stefan and welcome to CNC Kitchen. Recycling failed 3D prints, support structures and everything you don't need anymore is one of the big dreams of many makers and 3D printer owners. It's kind of sad that you often throw away quite a lot of material, only because you had a small layer shift or the dimensions were not spot on. For my 3D printing tests, I tend to use a ton of these 3D Benchies that are my benchmark models for 3D printers and materials and tell me so much about the process. They look nice, but since they are horrible floaters, I can't use them after print tests as a bathtub toy for my daughter, and therefore they pile up in my office. Since I currently have a desktop filament extruder and material shredder at my disposal, I thought, let's recycle these and make new filament out of them. I know that the 3DVO desktop filament extruder I currently have is not maker equipment with a price tag starting at 5,000 bucks. Still, due to its intended use in pre-production and labs, it's the perfect tool to easily show what needs to be done to make beautiful new material out of abandoned and failed 3D prints. In the end, this will give you a great insight into the process that you can try to apply even with self-built equipment at home, similar as I also have been doing it in the past with my Filastruder. This video will cover the recycling and extrusion process itself. In the following video, I want to discuss if such a system might be feasible at a larger scale and what the challenges and opportunities are. Please leave your ideas and opinions in the comments below. And if you don't want to miss the upcoming content, make sure to be subscribed and have selected the notification bell. Let's start with our raw material. If we just grind up all of the parts and melt them down, our final material would have a color that is a mixture of everything and would probably not look too nice. For this reason, I first sorted the parts for color. I separated red and blue ones from the rest because those colors were available in a significant amount. The leftovers that would not make sense to recycle separately will be ground up together as a mix. One of the most important things during recycling is making sure that we only have one type of polymer or only compatible ones. I thought I only added PLA benches to the bag, but during sorting I noticed that there were also a bit modified parts in there, like carbon fiber filled and copper plated boats that I directly separated out. These were easy to distinguish, but since a single PETG, ABS or polycarbonate part might ruin my recycled filament in the end, I thought about methods of how to make sure that I only have PLA. In industrial recycling, methods like infrared spectroscopy are used, but I don't have the equipment for that. Gravimetric separation could be used, but since my boats do all have different infill ratios, I wouldn't be able to tell them apart just by weight. The method I ended up using is the thermal properties of PLA, because it's the 3D printing material with the lowest temperature resistance. I put all of the boats in an oven at temperatures right above 60 degrees Celsius. When they were all heated through, I simply squeezed them with my fingers. The ones that became soft at that temperature are almost certainly PLA, and I rejected at least one boat in the mix because it felt differently. Next, we need to grind up the material into small flakes that can be fed into the extruder. We need to do two different things before we start with the process, and that's cleaning the shredder that there are no leftovers of other polymers or different colors in the machine that could spoil our regrinds. Then we need to clean the parts from rough dust, because everything that ends up in the regrinds will also be embedded in the filament and can potentially clog the tiny 0.4mm nozzle later when printing. Spoiler, that's harder than you think, but we'll see in a bit. In this case, I simply use compressed air for that task. The shredded from 3DVO combines a conventional shredder that slowly chews through materials and a granulator that uses sharp blades to grind down the smaller chunks as consistently as possible in just one run. Since a consistent and small particle size is very important for the extrusion process, I sieve the regrinds with a mesh size of roughly 3mm and put everything that's still bigger another time through the machine. The 3DVU Shredded is a compact machine and not super fast, so grinding up the 130 3D benches took me a good hour. In the end, I have 3 trays of very nice and consistent regrinds in red, different shades of blue, and everything else that was left. Even though I cleaned up the shredder thoroughly, I still ended up with some particles of other colors, but this is something you'll always have when you're working with recycled materials. Sorting that out would be too much of a hassle, so I just leave it as it is. Before I start with the extrusion process, I need to dry the material. It takes the material around 10 to 15 minutes to get from the hopper to the nozzle in such an extruder. Polymers degrade if they are kept at elevated temperatures or, in this case, even the molten state for more extended periods. One of these degradation processes is hydrolysis. The moisture in the material cracks up the polymer chains and therefore negatively impacts the melt and extruded filament properties. Removing the moisture minimizes that effect. Therefore, I put my regrinds on trays for a couple of hours to dry them at around 80 degrees Celsius and stir the material regularly to release its moisture content evenly. Then I fill the regrinds into airtight boxes. Let's finally get to extruding and start with our red regrinds. If you extrude regular industrial pellets, they are nice and round and flow well in the hopper. The ground-up 3D prints, on the other hand, have very sharp corners and irregular shapes, which causes them to lock up and not properly flow. For this reason, I added this vibration spider into the hopper that has a small vibration motor on the inside. Every couple of seconds, it vibrates for a short period and potentially releases blockades. It's not vibrating constantly because that might lead to a separation of small and big particles, which is something we don't want. I heat up the extruder to around 180 degrees Celsius. As soon as the temperature is reached, the screw starts turning and slowly feeds the material into the compression and metering zone where the material gets molten and thoroughly mixed. It takes some minutes until the leftover material from the last extrusion process is purged out, but at some point we are able to see a nice transition from clear to bright red. After the molten material comes out of the nozzle, it gets cooled by 2 blower fans, runs through a filament thickness sensor, and then passes the puller wheels. The puller and the diameter sensor form a closed loop control system. When the diameter is too high, it pulls faster and the filament gets more stretched. When it's too thin, it pulls less. As soon as the filament diameter stabilizes, we feed the end of the filament through the positioning lugs, then through the spool and start the winding process. We would have the possibility now to tweak the settings even further, but that's something I already did before. So if everything is well, it's time to wait until all of the regrinds have been converted into new filament. In the 2 hours I left the machine running, I extruded around 300 grams of material. The results look really nice with a consistent color and no major flaws that are directly obvious. The only thing I noticed is a slightly rough surface texture. If that's due to unmolten particles or even a different polymer, I can't tell, though the material still prints great. Extruding the blue regrinds went very similar. Once added to the hopper, I wait until the red material is purged out and again start spooling. The melt looks really nice due to some sparkly particles that were in some of the benches we ground up. If I connect the 3DVU extruder to my laptop, I can also track all of the extrusion parameters, like temperature, motor currents, and of course, most importantly in the end, the filament diameter. The machine was mostly able to keep the filament diameter between plus minus 0.05 millimeters, but sometimes showed major deviations from the 1.75 millimeters that we intend to have. This seems to be due to some melt inconsistencies, where something appears to be stuck and then releases. This is an issue I'm currently working on with the 3DVU team. I even sent them a sample of my regrinds that did extrude much better on their machines, so now we need to figure out what's wrong with mine. This could be due to residues in the extruder from other experiments that I didn't purge out properly and maybe partly blocked the barrel, but we'll see. After another 2 hours, we are greeted with another roll of PLA filament, made from 100% recycled 3D prints. Due to the mixing screw of the extruder, the color turned out really nice and even, and we don't see any gradients as we print with it. And finally, let's extrude all of the leftover regrinds of various colors and grades. This one will probably be more challenging than the rest because of the different brands and potentially different process parameters. The mixed up color turned out quite a bit darker than I expected, but still gorgeous with a nice sparkle. A dark trashbag khaki 2.0, and you'll know what I mean if you watched my first filament recycling experience. This material interestingly had the highest throughput with 158 grams per hour, so I was left with a nice spool of material in the end. Unfortunately, looking at the spool and also the statistics showed that there were even more extrusion inconsistencies that might require removing some pieces during printing. Even though there were some issues with the full mix, this was still a great learning experience and shows that the more diverse the mixture of materials you recycle, the more effort the recycling process might be. In the future, I want to try mixing different portions of virgin material to the regrinds to hopefully make the process more reliable, just as it's also almost always done in industry. Still, the material printed quite nicely, and there's not much to complain about. Of course, I wanted to go full circle and print a big 3D Benchy out of the mass of my recycled ones. This one is made at 300% scale and printed great, until I had a jam at some point. It turns out that there was a small metal shaving in the filament, probably because I didn't clean the parts well enough. This shows another challenge of recycling and might make it necessary to use a melt filter, so a small metal mesh in the extrusion path that filters these particles out. In other recycling experiments, I even found a particle of a silicone sock in the filament. Also not optimal. I recovered the print with some G-code trickery and decided to use the blue spool of 100% recycled material for the rest, which worked flawlessly. There are some tiny inconsistencies on the final part that result from the diameter variation, but in the end, if I'm able to get rid of the impurities and make extrusion even more consistent, this 100% recycled material might be great for prototyping, where quality doesn't need to be totally perfect. Well, and because you are watching CNC Kitchen, I also had to test the strength of my recycled filaments to find out if this process severely degraded the material properties. For this reason, I printed mini tensile test specimens in my 3 different recycled filaments and as reference from a spool of DAS filament cherry red PLA. Then I mounted them in my DIY universal test machine and loaded them in tension until they broke. The reference samples were the strongest, though the recycled specimens only slightly decreased in strength. Our red mixture was 6% weaker, blue 11%, and the mix 12%. None of the samples got brittle, and the decrease in strength might only result from the fact that the material I recycled were already weaker in the first place. A thorough degradation study is, though, definitely on my list. The only hint of degradation I noticed so far is that my recycled PLA is significantly more stringy than regular PLA, even though it should be bone dry. So there we have it. We've successfully created 100% recycled filament and gave more than 100 3D Benchies a new life. The material wasn't perfect, just because the process itself with all of the variables and steps is complex, which also showed up in my extrusion inconsistencies that I'm currently working on fixing together with 3DVO. Still, it was a great proof of concept to show that truly recycled filaments might be possible. I don't think that recycling at home will be a thing in the near future, though maybe there might be a service that could do that for us more economically and ecologically. But what's your take on recycling 3D prints? Not worth your while or essential in the future to avoid plastic waste? Let's discuss this in the comments. Thanks for watching, everyone. I hope you're doing all well. If you found this video helpful, then please leave a like, share it with the community, and make sure that you're subscribed. If you want to support the channel, head over to Patreon, become a YouTube member, or even check out my merch. Stay healthy, auf Wiedersehen, and until next time. We need to do